So welcome to this episode of The Vote. I'm here with Professor Rainer Schulze, who's a regular on our programme for Tales of the Margins, and we're going to be talking a bit about that in the second half. But Rainer, just talk about your how did you arrive in the UK and what you've been up to, because I know you've had a really distinguished background, particularly tackling discrimination, so and working on LGBT issues.
Well, I've done a whole lot while I was in this country. I came in the early 1990s, and basically that was the time, few people might remember, when then Prime Minister John Major wanted to put Britain at the heart of Europe. And that's actually how I came and why I came to Britain, because my first post was a Jean Monnet post funded by Brussels for 5 years. And universities that accepted these kinds of posts then needed to fund them afterwards as regular posts in their institutions. And my first task was, and I'm really ashamed to say that, to teach the history of European integration. And wow, did I fail, didn't I, when we move forward to 2016 and see the referendum.
Yeah, and so that was at Essex University, was it?
That was at Essex University. I had a couple of teaching appointments at Birkbeck and Roehampton, then still part of the University of Surrey before that. But the first major appointment was the University of Essex, where I then stayed for more than 20 years.
Yeah. Because I myself studied a master's in international relations, so I've kind of studied a bit of that at University of Sussex. So how did you go about teaching that? That because obviously for a lot of the our history we've been at war, Europe, and so the whole idea behind the European project in the 50s was, you know, with Claude Monet was to kind of bring Europe together so that we didn't actually, you know, go to war with each other. So
exactly.
With all of the unrest that's going, not taking place, not just in the UK but across Europe, what's gone wrong? Big question.
It's a really big question, and obviously it's a completely different generation. I was born about 10 or so years after the war, and grew up still very much under the impression of a war that was disastrous for the whole continent. The abyss into which Nazi Germany. Kind of threw not only Germany, but all of Europe, all of occupied Europe. For me, when I grew up, I didn't even dare to identify publicly as a German. We identified as European because being German was compromised by the Nazi past. Being European was something new, was something that was positive. So I still remember I was a very small kid at the time that students actually tore down barriers between the countries in order to show there's something new coming up. So it was a real enthusiasm for Europe. And that's what I tried to convey to my students, that Europe was born not as some dull institution that regulates the size of bananas, which it actually never did. That is an invention of the British press. But that it started as the idea that it would preserve civil liberties, human rights, that individual nation states were unable to preserve when the Nazis rolled all across Europe. And the problem with Britain, and I think that is actually at the heart of it, is Britain was never occupied by the Nazis.
How do you think that's affected the way that Brits look at Europe?
Well, I think...
And I do think there is a distinction between all of the countries in the UK. I think the Scots and the Welsh and Northern Irish might look at it slightly different. Maybe the English look at it...
Yeah, it's the English and the British that is English. I mean, it's always difficult to actually differentiate. But for those... political elites, let's put it this way, and they tend to be within Britain more English than anything else. There is the belief that the British institutions, the monarchy, parliament, etc., were strong enough to withstand the Nazi onslaught. And of course they did. I mean, helped by the fact that this is an island. And that therefore any form of cooperation or even supranational organizations such as the European Union is not actually necessary. Whereas the countries, the peoples on the continent, France, the Netherlands, Belgium, Poland, etc., etc., they experienced what it meant to be under Nazi occupation, of losing all rights, of being treated as subhuman, of being deported into concentration camps, and that their own institutions were unable to protect their populations, and that therefore it needed a higher authority to do that.
Yeah, and a lot of people in the UK just don't get, we don't get that. In fact, it doesn't actually enter our stream of consciousness, really.
No, it doesn't.
You kind of have to spend a lot of time in Europe or some time in Europe to kind of get that. I have to say that, you know, and that's a shame, really. But we'll come on to Brexit in the second half, but we don't look at Brexit from the European point of view. And we've kind of, a lot of people in the UK don't seem to understand it. They look at things very differently. They're used to coalition politics. They're used to deal making where you compromise. You know, compromising is a big part of the way of doing politics in Europe, and particularly in European institutions. We don't have that so much. We've had a coalition government with the Tories and Liberal Democrats, but we don't have that in our DNA.
But I'm not even sure that this is definitely one problem. Mm. That the kind of compromises, which means that the pendulum never swings as wide to one side and to the other as it does here in Britain. In a coalition government, you stay much more moderately somewhere in the center ground. That is nothing that the Brits really have as an experience, although now it is slightly different in Scotland, obviously.
Yeah.
But what I also think is different is that Britain always regarded the European Union as an economic union, as something that should bring economic advantages. And yes, it should, because by raising living standards, you also work against conflict. Because people who live in a reasonable standard will not necessarily go to war against each other. But the Brits, and Jean Monnet already said this very, very early onwards, you Brits will never understand the idea of Europe. The main core was protecting civil rights and civil liberties and human rights.
So, being in the UK, what have you learnt about our attitudes to Europe and about the way that we do politics in Westminster, given that you've spent a lot of time, you've had an academic career? What are the main key differences for you, not just now, but in the past in your career? What trends have you seen, and how has it changed?
Well, let's start with a very practical level, and many people won't see that. Britain has become extremely European in the last 20 or 30 years. When I came first to Britain in the mid-1980s, when I worked here at the Public Record Office, as it was still called then, there were no street cafes, there was no kind of Europeanness. Even London didn't have it. Now you see that everywhere. You couldn't even get coffee. So pub hours, all of these, this kind of leisure life that is now taken for granted. We had this in Europe much before Britain, but Britain has it now. Yeah. So it has become extremely European without realizing it. But what never changed is this this polarity of the political discourse. It's one side against the other side. It's Tories against Labour. And they are almost irreconcilable. No, that's probably not the right pronunciation. Positions. Whereas...
Adversarial.
Adversarial, that's the term. Yeah. Whereas in Europe, there is much more compromise. Mm. Sometimes compromise leading to making the parties indistinguishable, which is also not good. But in Britain, it is this adversarial character of politics that one government undoes what the previous government has done. This was even worse in the 1950s with the nationalization policies, etc. And that there is no real understanding that coalitions are not something that is evil, but is actually something that mediates, that helps a society to develop possibly slowlier, but actually in a more healthy way, with a broader consensus. It's consensus building. And what is even more surprising to me, even now after living in this country for more than 25 years or so, is that a system that Britain was instrumental in setting up in West Germany after the war never really took root in Britain itself, including a trades union organization.
Yeah, because in Germany, trade unions work in step with the employers. it's completely different. They sit on the boards.
They sit on the boards. There is co-determination, as we call it. There is, it is consensus politics. And even though many predicted that unification would mean an end to this kind of consensus politics, that it was only possible in the cozy shadow of the wall, if you so want, it has continued to a high degree. That trade unions see their role in society, in politics, in the economy, as being for their clientele, of course, but also seeing the whole as contributing to the benefit of the whole of the economy, the whole of politics, etc.
Okay, we'll leave it there for the first half, Rainer, and we'll be chatting about this again in the second half. So join us for the second half, where we'll be talking to Rainer about his career and also about Brexit, but from a different point of view. I'm here with Professor Rainer Schulze, who is a regular for on Latest TV for the Tales of the Margins programme, which we can just briefly touch upon. I know you've got a new series coming out, haven't you? So maybe we can tell the viewers about that.
Well, Tales from the Margins is a programme that I designed with films about the situation of LGBTIQ people from around the world, the situation of LGBTIQ rights around the world. My main aim, and it's a human rights kind of focused aim, is to make viewers aware that here in the UK, not everything is perfect, of course not. There's still homophobia, etc. But we live, LGBTIQ people live relatively secure lives, whereas in much around the world, the situation is very, very different. There are still death penalty in some countries against homosexuality. There is discrimination. There is still criminalization of homosexuality, etc., etc.
Yeah, and there are issues, particularly in Africa, from the legacy of Britain's past.
Yes,
where there's legislation that. Because we always criticise that, but actually sometimes it's actually British legislation, which has been
legislation introduced during British colonial times.
Yes.
Homosexuality tended to be, if not accepted, then at least tolerated before Britain and other colonial countries took over. The Brits then introduced their own sodomy laws in these colonies. And these laws, sadly, still continue in many of those countries and are now seen as part, if we go to Africa, as African culture, homosexuality as a Western import. But the law that was actually the Western import is now seen as upholding African values. In India, there was a big success late last year when the British legacy was finally abolished by the Supreme Court.
Yeah, and these are a lot of LGBT issues in these countries. They're still issues today. And you're saying that the root cause is legislation, or is it more an attitude problem or a cultural problem?
It is both. These two things go hand in hand. If you decriminalize homosexuality, it doesn't mean that you change social attitudes. But as long as you have a criminalization of homosexuality, social attitudes will not change. So these things go hand in hand. And you need to fight at both ends in order to increase the acceptability, to fight against prejudice, but also at the same time, very importantly, to change the law. Because if there's no law that LGBTIQ people can appeal to, they are completely helpless and up to the mercy of the state authorities or their neighbors.
Yeah.
And examples in Nigeria, in Uganda, in some of the Arab countries show how dreadful these consequences are. Many will remember the images when ISIS threw homosexuals from rooftops.
Yeah. What can we look forward to then in your new series? What are some of the highlights? What do you have planned for the viewers?
Well, one of the highlights is coming up very soonish, in about two or so weeks, two short films from mainland China, or the People's Republic of China, to give it its correct name. A young Chinese filmmaker who did two stunning films but actually ran into problems with the Chinese government because of these films, because they are not portraying the positive energy, as they call it, that the Chinese authorities expect. And those two films by a very young filmmaker are actually quite stunning, and I talk to him about the problems he's facing and why he did those films despite all the problems.
Yeah. So back to Brexit then. I mean, how's it feel for you being a German citizen but spending, you know, giving a lot to the UK in terms of your, you know, your expertise and your commitment to our university system? How's it feel at the moment? It feels like we're in the end game of Brexit, but maybe not. We don't know what's going to happen in the next few weeks. But it'd be good to get your perspective on it.
It's a limbo situation, and it has been a limbo situation since the referendum. I was pretty sure about 2 or 3 weeks before the referendum that Leave would win. Mm. It was pretty clear by the completely inept campaign that the Remain group led that Leave would have the upper hand. But the day after the referendum obviously was on a Thursday, the results were announced on Friday morning at around 6 o'clock. On that Friday, I went out for lunch with a friend of mine, a German friend of mine. I live in Portuguese London, central London, Lambeth, one of the highest Remain votes in the country. But I had this, I always call him this ugly white man. He was probably quite short, but the referendum result made him like 2 meters high or taller. And he almost spat into my face and said to me, "Have you packed your bags yet, mate? You will be out of here very soon." So that didn't really bode well. I know it sounds a bit pathetic, but I would argue I have served this country for 25 years. I have educated students, I have contributed as head of department, as director of the Human Rights Center in various management positions to the development of the university system. This is my home. And all of a sudden it feels as if for very dark reasons, the carpet is being stripped away from under my feet. I think it is absolutely disgraceful what's happening.
Yeah, I mean, that is disgraceful, no doubt about that. Can you understand where some of the reasons behind the vote for Leave, where people might be coming from?
Yes, I can understand.
Being an academic, I know that you look at all the evidence, so...
No, I mean, that was my first shock experience. I told you earlier that I came to Britain, or got this post at the University of Essex in order to teach the history of European integration. And in my first seminar with, I think it was second and third year BA students, when I came in really enthusiastic and said, "Well, let's talk about identity and how much would you feel European?" And I had this group of students looking at me as if I was a cuckoo case and telling me, "We are British or we are English." It wasn't quite clear which one. "We are different and we want to be different." So yes, that was always there. And I can understand how the referendum result came about. What I cannot understand is a political elite that is fueling the kind of xenophobia that you saw both in the run-up to the referendum and even more so after the referendum. This would have needed political leadership to actually put a stop to what was happening at the time. I still remember 2 days after the referendum, the Saturday, was London Pride, the LGBT Pride march through London. And after the march was over, there were thugs running through Covent Garden shouting, "First we throw the Poles out and then the gays." And yes, there were some kind of voices who said, "Oh, this isn't really acceptable." But there was no one actually standing up and saying, "Stop it. This has nothing to do with the referendum. This is not the British way of doing things." Yeah. I think Britain has actually lost its soul in this referendum and in the ensuing discussion about Brexit. What was good and valid and admirable about Britain is at the moment going down the drains. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that exactly. I mean, that has nothing to do with the referendum. It goes back to that, to the start of this episode of The Vote, where we spoke about compromise, because it's about What is very frustrating is that compromising kind of drive that we're normally very good at compromising in this country, and we don't have coalition government, but we're normally quite tolerant people. And
yeah, but where has this gone?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the big question. And I mean, there was a lot of discussion in the expat community, to which I never really counted myself. But the referendum result has actually created this feeling in me that, yes, I probably am an expat. It's similar, and I don't want to equate this in any way, but I'd still say this. It's similar to some Jews in Nazi Germany who only realized their Jewish identity after they were... Mm. after the persecution started. And it's similar when all of a sudden, I never thought about the fact that I was a German living in Britain. It was natural. It was what Europe was about. You didn't think about it. You didn't even think about applying for permanent residency or anything of that sort, because under European Union law, that wasn't necessary.
Yeah.
But all of a sudden, all these things are being kind of implanted upon you because of outside pressure, because of a lid has been taken off a bottle or wherever it was on. The genie is out of a bottle, and all of a sudden it was okay to be xenophobic, to be racist, to be all these ugly things which existed before, of course, but which were held in check because it was not tolerated.
Yeah.
Now it's tolerated.
Okay, we're going to have to leave it there. I wish we could talk a bit more, but thanks for coming in, Rainer, today.
Thank you for having me.
All the best with your new programme, and we'll touch upon this subject soon, I'm sure. So thanks again.
Thank you. Goodbye.